शक्ल भी आ जाएगी उसमें। गुड मॉर्निंग क्लास, टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट विद द कंसेप्ट ऑफ लीगल पर्सनालिटी। दिस इज अ रिविजन क्लास फॉर यू। वी हैव ऑलरेडी डन दिस कंसेप्ट अर्लियर। इनफैक्ट वी हैड स्टार्टेड आवर जुरिस्प्रूडेंस 2 कोर्स विद द कंसेप्ट ऑफ लीगल पर्सनालिटी ओनली। सो एज डिस्कस्ड अर्लियर, व्हेन इट कम्स टू लीगल पर्सनालिटी, अ फ्यू क्वेश्चंस मस्ट अराइज इन योर माइंड। फॉर एग्जाम्पल, वाई डू वी नीड लॉ रिलेटिंग टू लीगल पर्सन्स? Do slaves have legal rights? That is, can there be a person who is a natural person and still not be a person in the eyes of law? Then, can a non-human have a legal personality? For example, an idol or a mosque or an animal for that matter, being a non-human. Then how many kinds of persons are there? This question is very important for you because it seems that people who are not natural persons, that is living beings, are also considered as persons in law. So then how many kinds of persons are there? Then are women legal persons? See, these questions are very relevant, specifically when it comes to women being legal persons. There was a time when women were not considered as independent legal persons. This question seems to be slightly irrelevant to you now for the simple reason that women are legal persons now. But there was a time when women were not legal persons. Now the result was that if you wanted to sue a woman, you had to sue the husband also. Or if you want her to be sued, then also you would have to sue the husband, because husband was legal personality and she was not. Her status was attached to her husband's status. Now, the most relevant aspect when it comes to these questions is, if you give legal personality, then the person can sue and can be sued. That is, he can file a case and a case can be filed against him. But if a person doesn't have rights, for example, women in earlier times, then you could not sue and she could not sue also. That is, you could not file a case against her and she would also not file a case against you. So these are the inherent questions. When it comes to slaves, yes, the question is very significant in today's world also, because they are called imperfect persons. See, try to understand. The world as such is not in favor of slavery. But then the issue of slavery is coming up again and again because of various factors. So that is the reason why we need to think about the jurisprudence relating to slaves also. We cannot keep our eyes shut when it comes to these important aspects of contemporary world. Now, insofar as the definitions are concerned, we generally start with the definitions given by the German writers. German writers gave a lot of importance to whether a person has will to take decisions or not. So they would say that that will is the essence of the personality. And if he is capable of will, capable of taking decision in accordance with will, fine. Otherwise, he is not a legal person. For example, a slave would not be able to take decisions. Now, you can refer to any movie you have seen wherein a slave had to do whatever the master says. So, whether he likes it or not, whatever his personal opinion, doesn't matter. He has to follow the orders. Now, one of the most famous authors who has come up with this explanation is Zetman. He says personality is legal capacity of will. The bodiliness of men is for their personality a whole irrelevant attribute. So whether you have a capable body or not is very irrelevant. What matters is mentally whether you are capable of forming an opinion and taking care of that opinion. Similarly, Murer says the juristic conception of the juristic person exhausts itself in the will, and the so-called physical persona are for the law only juristic persons with a physical superfluum. So this is just a superfluum which we are carrying, our body, our bodily attributes. What matters is our capacity to be able to take decisions. Karlova says the body is not merely the house in which human personality dwells. It is together with the soul, which now has this life, is inseparably bound by it, the personality. Which means, not only as a being which has a possibility of willing, but as a being which can have manifold bodily and spiritual needs and interest as a human center of interest, is a man a person. So it would revolve around the same sort of concepts. Now here, what Salmond says is also very relevant. Salmond has very beautifully explained the entire concept. He says, a person is any being whom the law regards as capable of rights and duties. As being that is so capable is a person, whether a human being or not. And no being that is not so capable is a person, even though he be a man. So, till here, if you read, what you understand is when he says any being or no being who is not so capable is a person, even though he is a man. So, he clearly says, or he means, that slaves are not legal personalities. They are human beings capable of doing a lot of work, but not taking decisions. Then persons are the substances of which rights and duties are the attributes. It is only in the respect of that persons possess jurisprudential significance, and this is the exclusive point of view from which personality receives legal recognition. So this is what Salmond has said. Then comes view of Gray and G.W. Patton. Gray has also defined legal personality. He has defined legal personality as an entity to which rights and duties may be attributed, which means anything which is capable of holding a right or duty, whether it be in a human being or not, is person in law. So there may be a person who has duties but no rights. So once again, slavery, you have duty, you have all the duties, you need to follow the orders of your master, but then you don't have any right. You don't have a right to say back anything, respond back, or form your own opinion. Then G.W. Patton. So according to G.W. Patton, legal personality is a medium through which some such units are created in which rights can be vested. So this is how we move ahead with the topic relating to definitions of legal personality. So in a nutshell, we can say that whosoever is capable of forming a will is a legal person. And whosoever is not capable of will is not a legal person. Then origin and concept of legal personality. Now basically it starts with a Latin word called persona, meaning a mask. In ancient Rome, a variety of collegial institutions enjoyed personality. The Roman system was far more developed insofar as legal persons are concerned. Then there was this doctrine of persona ficta, which was made very popular by Pope Innocent IV. Now, there's a reason why we always attribute it to him. the doctrine of persona ficta had allowed the monasteries to have legal existence, but a legal existence different from the monks who were residing in it. So this simplified the difficulty in balancing the need for such groups to have an infrastructure. Now see, try to understand. The monasteries were to have properties, but the monk were expected to live in poverty because they had taken a vow of personal poverty. So this conflict could have been resolved if you could give a legal status to monastery, independent of who is residing in it or who is not residing in it. Now there is one more effect, and that is that fictional person in monastery could not be held guilty of delict due to having no soul, helping to protect the organization from non-contractual obligations of the communities who were surrounding them. So you could not have filed a criminal case against it. But then, if required, you could have filed a criminal case against the monks. So to do away with this kind of thing, monastery was given status. This effectively moved the liability to individuals acting within the organizations while protecting the structure itself, since individuals are considered to have a soul and therefore capable of being guilty of negligence. Now, at that time, what was considered was that monks can have soul, but monastery cannot have soul. So what doesn't have soul cannot commit a criminal act. See how relevant it was and how a particular need was taken care of by this doctrine. But then, as such, until 6th century, it denoted the part played by a man in his life. Post-industrialization, some changes came up. Now, initially, before industrialization, the typical business venture was either sole proprietorship or partnership. The owners were simply liable for the debts of the business. A feature of the corporation, however, which came later, is that the owner or shareholder enjoy limited liability. The owners are not liable for the entire debt of the company. But when the corporation breaches a contract or it breaks a law, there is no remedy because of limited liability, which protects the owners, and the corporation is not a legal person who can be subjected to criminal law. So at least in the beginning it was like that. Now the law has evolved. So please don't form that kind of an opinion when you enter a company law class. But initially, to begin with, when this concept was evolving, there was no accountability for corporate wrongdoing. And then there were five legal rights which were there. Right to have common treasury, that is to own property. Right to corporate seal, that is right to make and sign corporate the contracts. Then right to sue and be sued, that is enforcement of contract by a company. Then right to hire agents or employees who would work for the company, and right to make bylaws, that is its own self-governance. Now from this this old concept, things have evolved much when it comes to concept of legal personality as such. Now we come to the kinds of legal persons. Now see, insofar as this particular aspect is concerned, that is, what are the different kinds of legal persons? We have natural persons, number one. Number two, legal persons. So a natural person is a being to whom law attributes personality in accordance with reality and truth. So these are human beings, and they are persons in fact and in law also. But there could be some natural persons who don't have rights. Who could be that? The imperfect persons, for example, slaves. They are human beings, but they are imperfect persons in law. So you cannot call them as natural legal person, persons in law. Now then there are legal persons. So for legal persons, you should begin with the definition of Salmond. A legal person is any subject matter other than a human being to which the law attributes personality. So a legal person is thus anything. It could be real, it could be imaginary, to whom the law attributes personality by way of a legal fiction, where in fact there is nothing of that sort. So they are persons in law, but not in fact. Please remember this difference. Natural persons are persons in law and in fact. Legal persons are persons in law, but not in fact. They are described as fictitious, juristic, or artificial persons. For example, a company. Company is the easiest example you need to remember. Now, the extension of the conception of personality beyond the class of human beings is one of the most noteworthy feats of legal imagination. Personification conduces so greatly to simplicity of thought and speech that its aid is invariably accepted. And the thing personified is called corpus animus of a fictitious personality. Now, though it is true to great extent that legal personality involves personification, the converse cannot be true. So you cannot attempt just the opposite thing. Personification is a mere artifice of the speech, whereas legal personality is definite legal conception. So in common parlance, one speaks of estate of a deceased as if it was a person. It owns debts and has creditors, but the law does not recognize legal personality in such a case. So the rights and liabilities devolve upon the heirs and executors and not upon the estate. In other words, a group of person is personified as a single person, even though the law recognizes no body corporate. That is, a firm is a collection of individuals who have formed it. This is a personification, but there is no personality. One talks of judge as the court, of the jurors as jury, yet the jury is not a corporation. So though personified for the sake of convenience, so legal persons being arbitrary creations of the law may be as many as kinds pleases. They could be many kinds. So primary kinds are, there are three. Number one, corporation. The first class, this is the first class of legal persons. A corporation is a group or series of persons which by legal fiction is regarded and treated as a person. Second is institution. So the second class is that which in object, that which the object selected for personification is not a group or series of persons, but it is an institution. So a church, a university, all these things would fall under this. The third class is fund or estate. This is where corpus of some fund is some fund or estate devolved for special purposes. For example, a charitable fund, trust estate. These could be the various examples. Now with this, I end this particular revision lecture. Now if there's any confusion or you need some clarity, please do get back to me. Thank you.